Welcome to Gnostic Alchemy. My name is Genevieve Akal. I'm a Gnostic priestess and nun. Talk about raising the chrism within, or raising the serpent within, raising the Christ within. We're going to talk about this today because we're approaching an equinox point on the 23rd of September. So if you follow my work, I speak a lot about our annual journey, the annual Ouroboros, where you see the snake eating its tail, the annual cycle, and the hero or heroine's journey we each go through each year. And this correlates to the solstice points and the equinox points. And as we move through our year, and we are part of nature as living parts of her body, we of course experience these seasons in our own system. So this journey around the year also takes place in the energy centers of the body. So I've been thinking of calling it Kundalini Chrism astrology, because it's some astrologers read the stars, but I read my own body and the earth herself. And as we go around the cycle of the year, we have a journey that we're on a quest of personal expansion. We're coming up against obstacles, just like in storytelling. Everything is a story. And as we're coming into different obstacles and places of expansion, we're experiencing that in different energy centers in the body, right? And this whole process of going around the Ouroboros is the process of raising the chrism, or raising the Christ within. So fundamentalist Christians will read the Bible and think that the story is literal. But from the Gnostic perspective, it's not a literal story, it's a metaphor or symbol for this quest, or this physiological, psychological, spiritual experience of life, and how we can engage in our own life with awareness and tenacity and bravery to keep transforming. Around each cycle we go, we transform and we shed skin and we get bigger and we grow and we grow. But the problem in Abrahamic religions, the fundamental understanding of them, is that, well, in Christianity, there's this concept of this man that died for your sins, and so it's done. So I know a lot of fundamentalist Christians who don't work on themselves, because there's an undermining of personal agency when you believe that you've been saved by another person. Well, Jesus did it for me, so there's nothing for me to do. So here I sit in my pathologies. Because it is not understood and not taught from the pulpits that the mystical, truthful dimension of the Bible is that raising the Christ happens in each of our own bodies, in each of our own spirits, when we engage with our path and we understand the nature of the earth that we live in, the nature of the Holy Mother, this earth, her body, we are parts of it, her great spirit and her great guidance. So same in Judaism, right? You have this concept of waiting for a Messiah, waiting for the great one that will come. So nobody's kind of raising the chrism within themselves, right? And in Islam, Judaism and Christianity, the problem and the misconception, the reason this process has been missed or forgotten, is because the mother, Asherah, has been removed from the story. So over centuries, the Abrahamics have forgotten about the mother principle of God. There's just a father, right, who's very distorted because there's no mother in the picture. So I often hear Abrahamics say to me, oh no, we have woman, the Virgin Mary is in the Bible and we think she's amazing. Or Fatima in Islam. Oh no, we talk about Shekinah in Judaism. And I'm kind of like, yeah, those are characters or concepts in the Bible or the Torah or the Quran, but they are just strong women. You know, the Shekinah does speak more about like a power, but it's kind of just spoken of once and then forgotten. In all three of these religions, they do not mention the fact that the mother principle of God is the other half of God, and that you will not be liberated without her, that she is the source of your life, she is your very being, and unless you know her and work with her, you are living in a construct of a religion. You are living in dead ritual. The mother principle is not embedded in Abrahamic religions as a vital part of the full story, as the only part of the story. So that's the problem. So we have a lot of people in Abrahamic religions, two-thirds of the world, who are disconnected from their own bodies because the flesh is seen as Satan or the deceiver and something not to be engaged with, right? So a lot of rules are followed and there's a lot of behavioral codes, but nobody's actually truly liberated from their own ego. And the cycle of nature and her seasons, there is a code and an experience when we come into the skin in reverence of this temple. We come into awareness of how we are experiencing our lives in our body, what it feels like, what we need day to day. Right? It's the same thing as I often see people who have done one sport their whole lives, all day, every day, they do that one thing. And I'm like, but sometimes I need Ashtanga or a high energy sport. Sometimes I need yin or a low energy thing. If you are connected to your body, you wouldn't be living a militarized life where you do the same thing all the time. Because that your body clearly doesn't need the same thing all the time, because we have four seasons. And if you're always doing high energy stuff, that's you're living in summer all the time. And you're probably not in a healthy mental place or physical place, even though you might look physically strong and thin, right? Because you're not giving your body the space to live in a rhythm, right? So coming into this rhythm and experiencing what we need day to day, season to season, and witnessing that is coming into the knowledge of the mother and her flow, right? We have to graft into her vine. Most of us are grafted into our own vines, the vine of the matrix, which is quite mechanized. Oh, I have to produce this much each day. I have to do this. These are the obligations. I do this form of exercise all the time. So we grafted into a vine that wants to take from us, that kind of pulls a lot of energy out of us. But if we graft into the living vine behind me, I'm painting one, that's a work in progress. But if we graft into her vine, we grow with her energy and her rhythm, which is very nurturing. Sure, you know, there's fire sometimes and we move and we go, but then when we feel we have to come down, not expand, but contract, come into stillness, we do that. So there's no judgment of the rhythm. When we graft it into the vine of the matrix, the kind of mechanical vine, we're often judging ourselves, like, why don't I feel energized today? Why, you know, I need to get on top of this, I need to get on top of that. Whereas if you graft it into her vine, it's total self-love, and it's like, oh, my body can't do that today. I'm not gonna judge that. Okay, what do you need? What do you need? So it's a beautiful relationship with matter is mother in Latin, matter, the matter of your body. Because the falsity in Abrahamic religions is that the body is a deceiver, that the body is carnal and flesh and it's getting in the way of all the good spiritual stuff. But this is the great lesson in alchemy and gnosis, the wisdom of the mystics from any tradition, is that there are two hemispheres involved in our experience of life. The lower hemisphere, earth, and the higher hemisphere, sky. Mother, father. You can do different dichotomies. We can say yin, yang, Satan, Lucifer or Christos, Earth Mother, Star Mother, Lilith, Eve. What else have we got? Earth, Fire, Snake, Eagle, right? So there's these two hemispheres of the self and in our experience of this dimension that we're in, and it's spirit and matter, and they come together at the heart through Sophia, through wisdom. Sophia is a name for the mother. There's many names for her across cultures, but that unification of spirit and matter can only be facilitated by the Holy Mother herself, and she's embedded in earth. So there's the Earth Mother, she's embedded in the skin, and she's also embedded in the cosmos, the stars. So there's a Star Mother and an Earth Mother. And sometimes I like to say mother, father, right? It's the same thing. We're just using different concepts to describe these two hemispheres. So you see this this concept of two hemispheres coming together. Jung would say unconscious self down here and conscious self, or higher self. So these two hemispheres merging into the vesica Pisces, right, which is the fish, right? And we often see masters associated with the fish. Jesus is associated with the fish or the snake, right? It's that central point. So it's the merge of these two opposites in a mystical union and consolidation, alchemization and transformation. So it's our job to work with our body and our flesh and our desires. The Satan is ignorance. Satan, evil, is just ignorance, and we're all ignorant to ourselves in various ways. So it's our job to listen to what is coming up from below, the lower chakras, the Satan, and allowing awareness to lovingly observe and to have these two parts alchemize into a lived transformation. See, but in Abrahamic religions, when you're denying the Satan or the body, you're just trying to live up here with the Father. There's only the Father. You don't actually ever truly transform because you haven't transformed your own flesh. So it's all conceptual in fundamentalist Abrahamic religions. It's like, these are the rules. I follow the rules. I do the duties. I do the rituals. And that makes me holy. But the person is actually, they've got big egoic issues. They have a lot of judgment in them. They treat other people or think of other people in another way. They think they're super righteous and superior. So they've got all these massive egoic issues, but they don't even recognize it because they're following the rules. They're doing all the right things. So they're just living in the superficial construct of the Father. And until they admit that their body is part of the picture, that the body is actually holy, and that the Asherah, mother, needs to be resurrected alongside the Father, they will never be truly liberated. They will never know moksha. So before Asherah was removed from the picture, she was in the temple with El Shaddai. El Shaddai, El, and Asherah were in every temple together, and she was represented by a tree, the tree mother. And we see this in a lot of ancient cultures. So the tree is also an image of our nervous system and our body, right? And we grow as our own tree. We grow as a living tree when we graft into her living vine, her living wisdom. And that means full acceptance of the flesh and the Satan. And this growth of opening into more expansion and Christ consciousness over and over again. It's not a once-off thing. That's another Abrahamic problem. Oh, Jesus did it and it's finished. Or I'm enlightened now. No, it's a continuous growth, continuous expansion. And there is a alchemical map of what to look out for at different parts of the year. So at the moment we are approaching the equinox on the 23rd of September. And in March we have an equinox, and September we have an equinox, right? And then we have the solstice and the solstice in June and December down here. And these four points are actually the cross of Christ. That's the true cross of Christ, because Christ was, because Jesus, who isn't the Christ, all of us are the Christ. Christ is a alchemical possibility and reality in each of us. Jesus was a man, like many other masters, who grafted into the living vine and opened into his own expansion of Christ consciousness. So he's not the only Christ, but he came to speak about that Christ possibility. And that's why the cross of the earth, these four equinox, these two equinox points and the two solstice points, are actually the true cross of Christ. It's not the cross he was murdered on, because that is blood sacrifice, twisted, inverted Christianity. I don't even know what that is. The real Christ was a goddess lover. He was, Jesus was very much connected to Sophia and the mother and the rhythm of her seasons. And when he says in John 15:5, I am the vine, ye are the branches. He that abideth in me and I in him, the same bringeth forth much fruit, for without me you can do nothing. He's not talking about himself as a man. He would never do that, because that would be maniacal. He's talking as the voice of Sophia. He's talking about his mother. He is a representation of the mother. Every master that has come is speaking on behalf of the great wisdom mother, the great wisdom intelligence that is the source of all life and the source of all liberation. I often speak in that first person when I'm speaking for Sophia. I'm speaking her words. So I'm not saying I am the vine. Jesus is talking about the mother, Sophia, who is the vine. And nothing can be done without her. The Holy Spirit, the holy wisdom, the holy presence in our flesh, in the temple of the body. So as we're approaching these equinox points, this chrism process, right? So if you follow these videos, at the solstice points, just after the solstice points, we drop into the root and the sacrum. We go down into those deep chakra spaces where that it's the realm of the cave or the dark or the satan, where stuff is coming up, emotional stuff, difficult feelings, difficult situations. We're having a felt very, it's the inner child place. It's the place where the inner child starts calling up. A part of the shadow wants to be retrieved and integrated into the whole. So that starts to call out at those two places, just after the solstice here, right? And that is ultimately when the egg is deposited into the womb. So the root and the sacrum are the place of the womb, and whether you're a man or a woman, you have that womb space. And when we're in that shadow realm, the egg of possibility, the cosmic egg, is deposited in a spiritual sense in the womb of your being. Then as we move closer toward the equinox points, we come into the Manipura, solar plexus chakra, the fire, the soul, the place of the sun. And you often see Jesus depicted with the sun, and he's often depicted in front of this cross, right? The cross of the earth. That's his halo, because Christ, this physiological process comes through the earth process and your own psychological self-awareness. So as we move through the root and sacrum, we come into the solar plexus chakra, right? And that possibility wants to, the new possibility you have, you might notice, for example, an unhealthy pattern in your life, unhealthy attachment. Now that wants to shed, it wants to break off. Your cosmic egg, which is every possibility in the world, any kind of life, everything exists in that egg. So it's the possibility of something. And that possibility is defined by you and your own mind, because that's how powerful you are. You are co-creating every season, every year, whether you are involved in it or not. And I advise being consciously involved in it. So a possibility arises in your being. I need to step into this. I need to let go of this. I'm going to refine this. And it comes, as it comes into the soul, the solar plexus, right? As we're moving closer to the equinox points, then it starts to burn through the fire. And as we're approaching these equinox points, right, which we're very close now to the 23rd, this is when, at the equinox, you'll understand or see through these images that we're in half light and half dark. So we're in the middle way. We're in the Vesica Pisces. We're in the middle way of balance between mother and father. Those two hemispheres are unified at the equinox points. So you'll see in India, you still have a great preservation of fertility culture and this deep wisdom. Before the March equinox, they celebrate Mahashivratri, right? Which is where Lord Shiva, the father of awareness, the great father and the great beholder, it's celebrated as the day where he merges with Shakti or Prakriti, nature. So just before that equinox point, it's a celebration of the merge of Shiva Shakti, father, mother, the merge, right? And now in September, also in India, they celebrate Hatalika Tij. I don't know if I'm saying that correctly, but it's also a celebration of the merge of Shiva, the marriage of Shiva, the father, and Ma Parvati, Devi, mother. Right, they marry here. So just before equinox points, you have these two celebrations in the most ancient culture in the world of the merge of mother and father, right? The copulation of mother and father. So fertility cultures are very yoni-based. We see these gorgeous, beautiful, voluptuous women, big-breasted, vaginal, anxious, nurturing life, but it's also the phallus. It's also the big dick of fertilization and penetration, right? So we have these two, it's both mother-father fertility cultures, right? So at the equinox points, we have the great phallus. If we see the lingam, right? The shivling is the phallus in the yoni. It's a beautiful representation of this process and this nature, the nature of life, the nature of expansion. So at the equinox points, the mother and the father penetrates the mother. There's a penetration, a copulation that happens at equinox points because the egg is released at the root and sacrum area. And as we're now coming into the soul, sun, the place of the Christ, that's when the oil is released. So the egg has moved up to the Manipurna. It's between that area and this Christ oil is created in the brain. It's called the Christos in Greek. It's the sacred secretion that is created by the land of milk and honey, the pituitary and the pineal. And it is created in the brain and it moves down like a sacred oil and an anointing to fertilize that inner egg. Right? So if you want to know more about the brain function of the sacred secretion, I'll put a video below by Santos Bonacci. He does great videos on this physiological process, how it works in the brain. Now, in old alchemical texts, they say that it happens, the secretion comes down every month when the moon is in the sign, your sun sign. I don't know how true that is, because in my own gnosis, everyone's got a different gifting of gnosis. And in my gifting, I'm very connected to the earth's experience through my own body and my own experience. And I have noticed that that egg is formed and that secretion comes down twice a year, just before both equinox points. That's when the secretion comes down to fertilize the egg into the new possibility. Now, if you're unconscious that that is happening, you don't know that that is what is physiologically, spiritually occurring in your own body. This is a physiological process. If you don't know that, then this copulation is occurring, whether you're conscious or not. So when it does, when the oil unifies with the egg, that's the fertilization of a possibility that will occur. If you're conscious in this process and your own recovery and your own shadow work, you know what you're fertilizing. You know at this time, just before you come into the equinox, there's a lot of discomfort, a lot's come up. okay, I have the choice of the Satan wants to break through into awareness and transformation, but I'm going to have to make decisions in my life that aren't going to be easy. But I feel supported because I know the path of alchemy and I know how much peace and growth comes with this path. So we make that decision. And sometimes we, as it's burning through the soul, the solar plexus, there's this kind of fire it goes through. It gets forged. There's a forging, a fire of these two chemistries meeting, the egg and the secretion, right? And we sometimes feel that in our heart. It's starting to emanate into the heart, and there might be feelings of loss. There might be feelings of grief or sadness or whatever we're processing. But to walk the alchemical path of the raising the chrism means being deeply involved in one's own well-being and allowing and walking into situations where you're going to have to process discomfort. Because releasing attachment and growing is not easy. It's painful. But when you start to go, you know, do this process more and more, you're like, okay, I know how this pain works. I know it transmutes. I know it becomes my power. But a lot of people don't even, they have the possibility of a new reality, but then all the fears come in. What will I do without this person? I have to stay attached to this. I have to stay in this depleting position. And they don't make the brave decision when it comes to the fire of the soul. They don't make the decision. And the snake descends back down and stays in the realm of Satan, which is ignorance. It's willful ignorance. Satan is just ignorance. Fear. I don't want to change. I don't want to grow. But if we engage with this chrism now at the equinox, be aware of what is being something is being copulated, something is being fertilized. And either you are going to fertilize your own higher storyline, your own path of growth and peace and love and coming into the middle way and just refining the self more and more, and you know what this earth is about, because yeah, the matrix is real, but so is Eden. Eden and the matrix are dimensions side by side, and we can choose which dimension we are growing with, what we're adding to, what we're building. But if we are not aware that at equinox points, something is being fertilized, your co-creative power, your electromagnetic power, because it's in you, you're a very powerful being, whether you're using that or not, can be co-opted to fertilize a Kabbalistic storyline. So the cabal, the elites, they understand this knowledge. They know how the chrism works. And of course, they burnt the Library of Alexandria, they've murdered all the mystics. So anybody that was teaching this has been annihilated. So now we all just have like extreme religion that literally doesn't help us grow in any way. But they use Kabbalah. The Kabbal is called the Kabbal because they use Kabbalah, which is an occultist understanding of life, an esoteric understanding of life. And they use those mechanisms, those points of copulation, for their own ends. So at equinox points, they're often insane storylines are being launched on the world scene, right? And because all this co-creative power and this copulation is happening in every being, because we're all trees, we're all part of nature. So this is her cycle. This is her body we're on. This is her body we're part of and integrated into. So when copulation is happening, it's happening. And if we don't know that, if our attention and mind is drawn to a storyline like, oh, this crazy thing is now happening in life and it's real, it's super real, and agree, you should live in fear, you should live in fear, you should be restricted, these are the rules, obey this, this is the storyline. And people nod and go, yes, that's the storyline. Then you have given your copulation potential, you've given over your Christos potential to an outside external source, and you are co-creating a demented, fallen matrix reality. Most of the time, unconsciously, from your own ignorance, people do that. They do that from their own ignorance. So that's why it's important to kind of, I just wanted to give a bit more about this wheel of the earth, cross of the earth pattern today, because we're coming up to this equinox point and it is a point of copulation. So if we copulate the right seed, our seed, our personal growth. This is the cosmic egg, and I am seeing this potential in my life. It is done in the spirit first. So you, when we agree in the spirit with our mouths, with our body, with our being, that this is what will be for my life, and it's beautiful and it's scary because it's so expansive, and what will I do? I don't know, but I trust. I trust. And that's the thing about the path with the mother, Sophia, the great wisdom, the vine, the living vine, that she will always see us through. But you first have to take the step. And then, as the rest of the story continues, as we move from equinox to the next solstice point, there will be this energy, this chrism will be raised through the rest of the system. And I'll do more videos when we get to those points and what it might look or feel like. But now, because we're at the place of the soul, the fire, it's the alchemical fire, and you see this in a lot of imagery, right? The dragon and the dove, or the snake and the eagle. You see the furnace and the fire in old alchemical illustrations, because there's this burning through of watching an ignorance or an attachment of yours burn through the fire of the Christ awareness, the Christ understanding and strength, for more spaciousness, more emptiness. So I will say this as well, that this path, and I notice that the path of enlightenment and my own gnosis and going through the chrism over and over again takes me into deeper layers of emptiness. I'm not adding anything to myself on the path of expansion. I'm subtracting these things. It's an emptying of identifications, and I am this person, I earn this much, this is my likes, these are my hates, this is my religion. If you have to identify yourself with many things, you should probably engage in this process. And emptying is tough. Emptying can be scary, because you're taking away things that give you a sense of safety in the world. Oh, I can clutch onto this ego identification. So it's we're at that tough part. It's very easy at this point to be like, I don't know if I want to. I think I'm going to go backwards and just stay in comfortable numbness and let the snake retreat, right? And then we stay in Satan in that area of our lives. But of course, we let it go through the fire. I'll do further videos as it moves into the higher heart, the throat, and the crown. And then there is we raise that chrism. So the oil has gone down to meet the egg. It's fertilized the egg. And it's going to be at maximum fertilization at the equinox, perfect mother, father, copulation, Shiva Shakti. We stay aware of what we're doing. We'll move through the discomfort, move through the feelings. And then that wolf continue to rise up the system and open into the pineal, open into expansion, open into a new level of self. Right? And then, boom, we'll drop straight back to the root, and a new egg will be deposited at the next solstice. So the chrism, in my view, in my own gnosis, this isn't written in any alchemical literature, but the chrism, because it was all burnt, but the chrism in my gnosis is raised twice a year. And they're part of the same journey, right? There's an overall hero's journey we're going on. We're going on this quest of expansion of self, and we get to these big turning points when the chrism opens up. So, yes, I think that's all. I will attach... Yes, I'll put that Santos Bonacci video below if you want to look more into the sort of brain functions of the sacred secretion. A lot of alchemical writers and thinkers talk about what's actually happening over here, but I like to talk about what that looks like in life and what is happening below. I know the serpent very well, the Satan, right? So the Satan comes from below to meet the Christ that comes from above, and they alchemize each other. They unify matter and spirit together. Okay, so sending you so much love for raising your chrism and the equinox coming up, and a reminder to sink into your own heart, that deep wisdom and come into agreement with what is being fertilized in your life. What expansive, beautiful opening is being fertilized in your life. And just know that if it's scary, because growth usually is, you will be held and supported always, always. Sophia, the mother, and this Holy Spirit presence with us loves her warriors. She loves those. She loves everyone, but she especially surrounds those who are on their path and conscious and choosing and growing. She wants everybody to be doing that, right? And she's in us. I say she's this external beautiful being, but she's actually internal. It's like an internal wisdom. But you'll be supported. Okay. So sending so much love and see you soon.